church, we invite you to stand and sing, to God be the glory. The Lord hath done great things for us, whereof we are glad. It says that in Psalms 126, verse 3. Let's sing of that joy together.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the
soggy Sunday morning, but aren't we thankful? Yeah. In everything, give thanks. And we're always grateful in North Central Texas for rain. And boy, didn't it rain. My devotionals this morning was focused me on Psalm 145, verse 15. It says, all of our eyes look to the Lord, who gives us what we need in due season, or just when we need it. And I was reminded that, number one, you know, we look to God for everything. So aren't we thankful for shelter and health and more than enough food, right? And just strength for this day. And so many things abundantly all week long, Monday through Saturday, that our God is faithful. And he's always on time. He says he gives us what we need, right when we need it. He's not early and he's not late. He's always right on time. So Sunday is about separating ourselves from Monday through Saturday and taking time to acknowledge the one who gave us everything and gives us everything. And our eyes are upon him this morning. The greatest gift that he has given us is our salvation in Christ our Savior. And you know, houses can flood and cars and all of those things. But we have the gift of Christ, and it's never in jeopardy, ever. Isn't that wonderful? Yeah, never in jeopardy. And I trust you have that possession of faith of Christ in your heart, and that propels you to be here today. So we're glad you're here. The Bible says if we have friends, we must do what? Let's greet one another. Thank you. Be seated. Sundays are just a good time to put God right where he belongs, back in the middle. start with him. Put him in the center. And our nation needs to do that again. We've got a great God, and we celebrate that. You've got your worship prompter. This is the fourth Sunday, the 23rd, the fourth Sunday of September. So this is the Mission Sunday. We are very involved in worldwide missions, and so we encourage our membership over and above their giving and tithe and such to give a special offering. We have offering envelopes for that. Greatest gift that you could ever give is the gospel, and that's the answer to every need. And so wanted to bring that to your ministry, to a mind, and that this wonderful ministry of missions is a focal point for today, this morning and this evening. So now next Sunday, we have a special Sunday. It's our Focus Sunday, and we're looking forward to casting a new vision for the new year. He that aims at nothing almost always hits it. So we need to be focused. And, there's a lot of aimless, living today among Christians and apathy. So I really am excited about our new yearly focus for our church that begins in earnest in October and will follow us through the whole year. It always takes us on a great adventure. So what we're doing this day, there's a sign-up list for a meal. Everything's provided. Just come. And we have our worship service, then we'll eat together, and then have an afternoon setting for our afternoon worship and launching our focus in the afternoon. And so no Sunday evening next week. So be sure and sign up for that special meal, as we're providing it for you, and it helps us to know just how much to get, how much grub to get, right? Pray for all. We've got three possibilities for surgery this next week. Sister Ella Mae Harris has a special test tomorrow determining whether her back surgery is going to happen or not on Friday. So pray for her tomorrow. Just pray for her all the time. She's got a lot of pain. Tomorrow, Brother Pettijohn has his surgery. So just give him a hug today. Not too hard, but give him a hug today. And he and Susan, and pray for them as his surgery is tomorrow. Brother Jeff Dinner has surgery on Tuesday, so it's going to be a hopping week. So we always pray for one another, especially these that we're mentioning today. All right? We'll ask our ushers to stand and receive our offering. Lord, we love you, and we thank you for Christ our Savior, him coming to us, taking on flesh, bearing our sin, and rising on the third day. Lord, and ascending into your presence, now our high priest. Lord, we just thank you for all spiritual blessings in Christ. We're rich. Help us, dear Father, never to forget who we are and what we have in him. And Lord, may that warm our hearts and open our hands to give back to you. And we honor you today with this offering in Jesus' name. Amen.
I hear the rolling thunder.
was plunged beneath that flood, God saved. Oh, since then I walk in forgiveness. All of my guilt was erased. The sins of the past are broken at last, God saved. Oh, I got saved.
I'm undone by the mercy. The goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. How could I want more?
I've seen nothing but goodness. I've tested and tasted your grace.
I was so lost till I fell at the cross and God saved. By the ones he came to save, till on that
power of Christ. I'll stand here in the power of Christ. I'll stand. Amen. Brother Doyle Walker, would you lead us in a word of prayer?
Somebody's praying for me. Mighty hands are guiding me to protect me from what I can't see. Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. Somebody's praying for me. Angels are watching. I can feel it. Angels are watching over me. There's many miles ahead till I get home, till I'm safely kept before your throne. But Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. Your angels are watching over me. 'Cause I've walked through barren wilderness where my pillow was a stone, and I've been through the darkest caverns where no light had ever shone. Still I went on 'cause there was someone who was down on. And Lord, I thank you for those people praying all this time for me. Somebody's praying. I can feel it. Somebody's praying for me. Mighty hands are guiding me to protect me from what I can't see. Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. Somebody's praying for me. Somebody's praying for me.
If that didn't minister to your heart, I don't know what would. Wow. Certainly something that touched my heart. This is the fourth Sunday of September, so if I'm correct, this is the fourth message on prayer. I've often thought of myself as a butterfly or a bee, with, you know how they will go from this flower to this flower to this flower to this flower to this flower. You know, they hop, 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 hop. So, I mean, that's almost every week. And this week, earlier in the week, I was thinking, well, I'm going to preach on intercessory prayer, and it's going to be in Genesis, and it's going to be Abraham as he intercedes for Sodom. And then I hopped off of that flower, and then I thought, no, it's going to be in Exodus, as Moses intercedes for that whole golden calf affair, stands between God and his people, and I knew that's where it's going to be. And then, no, I thought it would be Jesus' great intercessory prayer in John 17. I really knew that, okay, that's where I'll be. What a great prayer. And then, no, I thought about in Acts, because I'm reading through Acts, and Peter was in jail, and the church got together and prayed him right out of there. And I love to talk about Rhoda, who's at the door. Just can't even believe that. But no. So, I stopped hopping for a while, and I ended up here. And it's a great 8 verses on prayer. And it's very, well, Paul's instruction concerning prayer. And I had peace there, so here I am. Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. That's what I do. First Timothy chapter 2. First Timothy is a letter written by the Apostle Paul on his fourth missionary journey, and somewhere around 63 to 65 A.D. And this letter contains instruction for the younger Timothy, a young pastor, as he pastored the church that's located at Ephesus. And we're teaching through on Sunday evening the letter that was addressed to this church. And Paul had left Timothy in Ephesus, and he traveled on. And this is just what Paul did. He traveled on to Macedonia. And realizing that he just might not get back to Ephesus real soon, he wrote this letter to Timothy to supervise, help him as a young pastor to supervise really what was a growing church in Ephesus. And 1 Timothy is the first of 3 New Testament letters called the pastoral epistles. An epistle is the wife of an apostle. No. An epistle means letter. So it's the first of 3 letters that are called pastoral letters. The second would be 2 Timothy, and the third one would be Titus. So that's what where we are in the pastoral letters. And in 1 Timothy chapter 1, after his greeting, personal remarks to Timothy, he doesn't waste words. He challenges and instructs Timothy not to go weak on doctrine, you know, to stand in sound doctrine. And then he talks about the proper use of the law. And we talked about legalism. You should have been here for that message. It was really different. We talked about legalism Wednesday night and the proper use of the law. And then he challenged them to fight a good fight, a good warfare. That, you know, we're in this and it's a battle. And then one of the great sound bites coming out of chapter 1 is 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15. And I love this verse. It says, "This is a faithful saying worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came to the world to save sinners." Isn't that great? You know, that's why he came. That's why he's come. But then he added, "Of whom I'm the poster boy." You know, I'm the chief. I'm the greatest sinner. And there's the humility that was in the life of Paul that helped make us just love him so much. The Apostle Paul now goes to chapter 2. Of course, this is a letter. There's no chapter 2. He just gets to the next thing he was wanting to instruct Timothy about. And it's interesting because chapter 2 is about worship. It is. We're here. He is about worship. And the first thing he mentions here in chapter 2 is instructions in prayer. Notice verse 1. "I exhort thee therefore that" what? "First of all." So there you go. This is the first of all. And then he goes on to say supplications, prayers, intercessions, giving to thanks that are made. So obviously the topic of prayer was now in chapter 2 the top of the list of things that Paul thought was very, very important, necessary to cover with the young pastor Timothy. It's interesting, Corey Timboom would concur. She says, she asked the question, "Is prayer your steering wheel or is it your spare tire?" Well, Paul says, first of all, you know, first of all, and so for sure Paul views prayer as a very important part of public worship. Prayer, spoken or unspoken, often steers us into worship. That word exhort means to urge, to strongly encourage. Okay? And then he adds, first of all. So I strongly encourage, first of all, which reveals just how important prayer should be for Christians and for Christian worship. When you look at all Paul's letters, by the way, embedded in his letters are prayers. Not only his mention of prayer, which he does a lot in his letters, but he even in prayer in the letter has prayers, his prayers. Oh, wow. You want to look at your prayer life and look at his prayers. Compare yours with his. Wow. And before we continue, we need to make an important observation here. And I think it's a vital connection. There is a vital connection between leadership and prayer. Keep in mind, this is Paul the Apostle writing to Timothy the pastor. Okay? So as Christian leaders, and I'm talking about leaders in the church. I'm talking about leaders at home. This is mom and dads at school, at work. We must stay connected to the Lord and through an active prayer life, right? I mean, it's through prayer that we obtain guidance and direction. I mean, honestly, that whole butterfly bee thing, you know, about was it here, Lord? Is it here, Lord? Is it here, Lord? That was prayer. I mean, I'm talking to the Lord. It might be, you know, staring, going back and forth or here to the heart, but I'm thinking about turning it over in my mind. And so you're getting direction and you're getting strength. And so it's through prayer that we even maintain our own hearts. Now listen, I have to keep my heart. I can't keep yours. You know, you got a fire and you're feeding the fire. Think about that. You know, you're camping and somebody's got to feed the fire. It goes out, you know. Well, you got to feed your own fire. And many times it's prayer that does that. So he continues, "I exhort you therefore, First of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, giving of thanks be made. So Paul begins by listing different words and phrases here that pertain to prayer. You got different English translations that may say these words differently, but they're all here. So these different words focus more on your scope of prayer rather than types of prayer, okay? It's just how broad the scope of your prayer. For example, the word supplication, it just simply means request, right? To entreat, to ask. You know, you have not because you ask. And sometimes you even ask for the wrong things. And so certainly we know that prayer, when we pray, we ask God to provide. I started this message, this worship service, with Psalm 145, verse 15. Lord, all eyes look to you for our meat, for our daily meat. You know that you give us in due time, in due season. And so supplication. And then there's the general word prayers in the King James Bible, whatever it is in yours. It's a general term that includes all communication with the Lord. Our prayers can be and should be an ongoing conversation with God. You know, ongoing conversation with God. I mean, why should you, where should there be a time where you can't pray? I understand when you're engaging your mind and talking to someone or whatever, but wow, every day is just wide open to have this ongoing, continuous in prayer. And then intercessions, and that's where I was headed first on this message. I didn't get there. But intercessions means to gain an audience with God. You know, Abraham gained an audience with God. He says, you know, what about 50? What about 40? What about 30? You know, here we go, talking about interceding on the behalf of someone else. And so when you're interceding in prayer for someone, you're really taking up their cause, their situation. You're no longer neutral. But through prayer, you're making their battles your battles. Okay, you're making their needs your needs, their cause your cause. And I'm going to you, Lord. I'm entreating you. I want an audience on the behalf of a daughter, a son, a grandparent, a work associate. Lord, they're having struggles right now, and I'm talking to you and asking you to act in behalf of them and help. So there we go. And then the phrase, giving of thanks, speaks of our expressing gratitude. You know, every prayer ought to be not just give me, but thank you, Lord, for blessings received, for anticipating answers to our prayers. You know, this morning I talked about here we are 6 days, you know, and we ought to be thankful, looking over our shoulder for all that God has done this week and given us. Yeah, so these words, these phrases here reveal a desired depth for our prayers. And so often our prayers can be just the opposite of that. They can be very, very shallow. They can be very, very predictable. And so often our prayers become that way. And so Paul's reminding Timothy, as pastor, you know, teach the people to pray deep. Teach the people to intercede and ask for the right things and be thankful. Teach the people that, you know, you can pray 24/7 and God's, you know, always ready to hear and answer our prayers. And so he's instructing the pastor. And so in verse 1b, Paul moves from challenging the scope of our prayers to the recipient of our prayers. He says, I exhort thee, first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, giving of thanks, be made for all men. Wow. When we pray for everyone, should get in our prayers. You know, and that's the reason we love little kids, because, you know, Spot or, you know, the cat, the dog, you know, will get in. As long as you don't pray for squirrels, I'm all right with that. No. I just put a collage up there. I mean, we're to pray for the whole world. I mean, God's interests and thoughts encompass that. Don't you think so? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That's everyone. All men we are to offer. Okay. Let's go back to the earlier. Supplications, prayers or petitions, intercessions, giving of thanks for, talk to me, all men. So let me ask you this morning, how many people find their way into your prayers? Your prayers, if your prayers were a blanket, how big would that blanket be? How many
How many would it cover your prayers? Most Christians find it easy to pray for their family, their friends, their loved ones. But it shouldn't stop there. We know and serve a God who is mindful of all men. Now listen, no matter their political views, religion, nationality, geographical location, or disposition. Let me just tell you something. You know, I hate politics. It ruins everything. Politics ruins everything. It ruins sports. It ruins government. It ruins the army. And it ruins church. Rise above it. It'll make you sour and bitter and angry. Flush it. I mean it. Rise above it. Get a better worldview. Come on. I don't care where you lie in that political spectrum. I tell you what, and I just don't listen. I thought, man, I'm getting all tense and angry. Don't have time for that. God is still God. And he can change anybody and anything. Come on, we're going to be talking about this. You know, yeah, how big? You know, how big? We know a God who cares for all men, no matter political, no matter. We should never meet anyone in a lifetime that we could not or should not pray for. I'm just telling you. But no. And then he goes on in verse 2 and gets into politics. For kings. I mean, if you notice, Paul didn't qualify these kings. Well, I didn't vote for him. He's got a bad haircut. He's got a big, my button's bigger than yours, you know, and there's that guy over in North Korea. I'm not going to pray for him. Oh, really? Paul didn't tell Timothy to only pray for good kings. He says just kings. And Paul makes this statement. I want you to know, and as he's writing this, you know who's king? Nero. Nero ruled Rome. And at that time, there was a growing threat of persecution against Christians. So later when Nero needed a scapegoat, we all know that, the fire that destroyed Rome in AD 64, you know who he blamed? Christians. That triggered a great, severe persecution throughout Roman Empire. Paul's prayer blanket covered Nero. And there's a reason, and you're going to agree with me before this is over with, if you're having problems with this. Then it continues, for kings and for all that are in authority. Paul said that we should pray and give thanks for all men. And here he connects that thought with those that are in authority over us. We should pray. We give thanks for those who are in authority. You know why? Because you need to read Romans 13. Because God ordained government and gave them authority to keep order and to protect us from evildoers. And so all that are in authority, and we need to pray for everyone in authority, from the law enforcement to the crosswalk helper. Amen. You know? Okay, now you can go. You know, that's an important position. We need to pray for all in authority. Well, why pray for all kings and people in positions of authority? Well, the answer is obvious. It's change. Although God is all-powerful, he's all-knowing. How wonderful. He has chosen to let us help him change the world through prayer. Yeah, through prayer. I mean, how exciting to think that our prayers can reach and influence the powerful, the movers and the shakers of this world. And later in this passage, we're going to learn that we're to pray evangelistically. Can you think of a better way to change a leader, whether it's a president or a king, than to pray that they'd be saved? Yeah. Does God just get a hold of them? You think it's possible? You got a Bible that talks about all kinds of kings that were pagan, really, got saved. Really, got saved. And so, pray for them. Pray for your
all kings, all leaders, all under authority. And this is for kings' authority, that we may lead a quiet, notice in verse 2, and peaceable life. Now, let's look at this. Let's pray for all of these people because of this. That's Myanmar. I don't know if you keep up with that. United Nations, we saw it in the paper again. I've been mindful of it. A fact-finding mission this last Tuesday was published. 44-page report, continual persecution. They're persecuting the government of Myanmar, persecuting Muslim refugees. Well, I'm not going to pray for them. Oh? Well, you better. Because those Muslim people right there, there's Christian people in Myanmar as well, by the way. But if they're not, there's people, if they're not coming after them, they're coming after you. And it's atrocious. I mean, the report based on 800 interviews, survivors, video, photos, satellite images, detailed atrocities, civil rights abuses against the community. And during their operations, the Myanmar armed forces have systematically targeted civilians, including women and children. They've committed sexual violence, voiced, promoted exclusionary, discriminatory rhetoric against minorities, and established a climate of impunity for its soldiers. The report said that Myanmar's policy of destruction and Rankine might have destroyed evidence that could have helped future investigations of crimes. Genocide. I mean, they're just butchering them. That was World War II. No, it's every day. It's every day in nations. We pray to live in peace so they can freely exercise our faith. That's why we pray for our kings and all of those that are in authority. We're often guilty of not praying for our president. We're guilty of not praying for our elected officials here in America as we ought. Why? In the United States, freedom of religion is constitutionally a protected right, provided by the clauses in the First Amendment. But what if we as Christians lived in parts of Hindu-controlled India? We know we support missionaries in Hindu-controlled India. And I mean, they are under the thumb and fist of officials, Hindu officials, who constantly threaten them and try to impede their work of spreading the gospel and helping children and orphanages. What about Muslim-controlled Pakistan or the Sudan? I mean, would we be more conscious of praying for change if we lived there? Would we be praying for the salvation of our leaders, or at least for them to experience a change of heart as to how they treat people? I mean, we take good government for granted, and the people said. And our good government can become corrupt. Our religious freedom in America has already diminished significantly. Every day, decisions are made in the hall of government that shape the present morality. Well, I tell you what, you can legalize a lot of things, but it's not right. God's moral law still stands, and it will continue to stand. Also, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor, what? As yourself, and that's the unborn. As a close neighbor. Decisions they make, they can alter, like that, our freedom to live a peaceful life as Christians. That's the reason he says, you pray. And you pray a big prayer blanket. You cover all humanity and you cover all kings. And get your nose out of your own little affairs and think about those that are suffering in other parts of the world. Don't be so self-absorbed. Verse 2 continues.
in all godliness. The word there speaks of piety and honesty. And so that phrase, all godliness and honesty, describes people of religious devotion. You know, that's the hope of America. If my people who pray, right? My people. And Jesus has placed us in this nation. And that's us right there, in all godliness and honesty. You know what that means? Jesus says he's left us here to be salt. He's left us here to be light. Shine your light. They may see your good works, glorify your Father which is in heaven. I mean, that's why we're here. We're Christians first. This is what I believe. Always have. We're Christian first and American second. And I tell you, that's Christians everywhere. We're citizens of a better country. Doesn't mean we don't love our nations. We have responsibility to be good citizens. But I tell you what, I'm a Christian first. And a lot of times my nation doesn't share my values, sad to say. Biblical values. Well, you tell you what, you ought to obey God first. Your first loyalty ought to be Christ. And by the way, even when it comes to your parents, we're going to talk about that tonight. They may be doing wrong. Well, children, obey your parents. Well, there's sometimes you better not. If the way they're leading is contrary to God and His Word, for this is good. Notice verse 3. It's good and it's what? Acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. That word good is often used by Paul in the letters here to Timothy, 1 and 2 Timothy, and to Titus. And the Greek word here for good emphasizes the idea of something being good in and of itself, just not in its effect. In other words, prayer, it's just a good thing. It's just good, good. Paul says, God our Savior Jesus Christ loves it when we spread our blanket of prayer over all men, which includes kings and people in authority over us. He kind of draws a line there for a minute. He says, this is just good. I mean, if you always need something to do, and you know you don't want to do what's good, pray. Just pray. Ask God to, you know, make a list, and God help us to be better at prayer than what we are. Come on. And we're all guilty of this. It's the easiest thing that we could ever do, and yet it's the thing we don't do. Verse 4. What about this God? In the sight of our Savior, who will have... Here, have you seen these two words again? We're to pray for what? All men. And now this God, our Savior, will have all men to what? Be saved. So why do we pray? We pray not just that we might live a peaceful life and be able to practice our faith and be salt and light, but we also pray so that everyone can experience and know the peace of God. And that only comes in Jesus Christ. I mean, we pray for the salvation of all men. This is an evangelistic prayer. No one is too far gone. No one is too lost in sin that God's grace cannot reach. Can I have an amen for that? Yeah. No one so high, so powerful, so talented, so mighty, so great in the world's eyes that doesn't desperately need God's grace. And all people are sinners in need of a Savior. There you are at the Tom Thumb or where the Wally World or wherever you are and you're about to check out and they got all those glossy, glamorous pictures that of all these wealthy, famous, miserable people. Come on. Foolish. They need prayer. They need God's grace. All people are sinners in need of a Savior. You may not be able to gain access to those individuals and talk to them about God. I tell you what, you can go boldly before the throne of God in heaven on behalf of all of those people and intercede for their eternal souls. That they would know Christ. Verse 4. Tells us that God will have, He desires all men to be saved. Aren't you glad you deserve and love a God like that? I mean, God's desire is not to be confused with His decree. I mean, this verse doesn't support the universalists' belief that everyone will eventually be saved. Everyone will not be saved, but listen, everyone can be saved. Do you believe that? Everyone can be saved. Because notice, it says it right here. You can claim this verse, for that God's desire is that all men be saved. That's just after he's talked about all kings. That's why he's talked about all positions of authority. And if God desires all men to be saved, then there must be provision for all men to be saved. Someone has said that God's will to save is as wide as his will to create. And so I find this all through the Bible. I mean, this kicks open our prayers. This kicks open the grace of God. This is how how wide your mercy is, God. Notice what Peter says in 2 Peter 3:9. The Lord's not slack concerning his promises. Some men count slackness, but his long-suffering to us. Aren't you glad? Not willing that any should perish. That what? There's that word again. All should come to repentance. And so all means all, and that's all that all means. And so we should view thinking all of the above that we've talked about, all men, women, boys, and girls, regardless of who they are, regardless of where they are, we don't need to view all of them as someone for whom Christ died. That's it. And that person you're in line with, wherever, or that you're forced to spend some time with, or in an elevator, all need Christ. And can God's desire be frustrated? Well, sure, God's desire can be frustrated. I mean, God's decree, his eternal purpose, cannot be frustrated, but God's desire can be frustrated. I mean, one obvious example is Matthew 23, verse 37. Jesus weeps over the spiritual condition of Jerusalem. He says, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killed the prophets, you stoned those that sent to thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathered chicks under her?" But you know what? Talk to me. You wouldn't. I would. He came into his own, but his own. But as many as would receive him. See, not everybody will. God is love. I mean, he's not going to violate. He's not going to force you. I mean, that's not love. That's not love at all. It's God's desire today that every lost sinner be saved. And if that's you, then that's you. That's you. And perhaps God will convict your heart today. Your need of salvation. I'm not capable of doing that. But I tell you what, now, I've been on the receiving end of the work of the Holy Spirit to just cut right to the heart. Haven't you? And started all my arguing with God, just dried it right up. And showed me my need of a Savior. But you can foolishly surrender. You can. You can foolishly say God's desire also includes your spiritual growth. Notice he doesn't stop in verse 4. He says, and come to the knowledge of the truth. His desire is that first, and I think this is first very important. It's needful. You know, you're spiritually discerned without the indwelling Holy Spirit. His desire is that you be saved and then come to the knowledge of the truth. So while it's true that man must have certain knowledge of the truth, the gospel, to be saved, there remains much to be learned after salvation. And the word knowledge here, it's interesting in the Greek, expresses a deeper, fuller, expanding knowledge. And so we have church this morning. We have another opportunity tonight. We're in Ephesians chapter 5, or chapter 6. We're flipped over to chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. And then, you know, Thursday night, the ladies have a Bible study. And then I'm going to study on love, legalism, the law, and license on Wednesday night. I mean, and my goodness, you ought to be in your Bible every day. Perhaps, I mean, that's God's desire, that his knowledge talks about deeper, fuller, expanding knowledge. The new birth is just the beginning. It is, of a life of growth and a life of maturity. And there's a lot of Christians out there who are quote-unquote saved, but you wouldn't know it. Because, you know, they just have not pursued. They pursued the world. That's what they've done and are. but not the Word of God. And once you're saved, God equally desires, as Peter says, us to grow in grace there in 2 Peter 1:18. Notice this. Grow in grace and in the what? Knowledge of our Lord Jesus, Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so it's just all through the Word of God. And once you're saved, oh, by the way, don't forget about baptism. Why? I'll tell you why. It's commanded by God. It's exampled by Christ. Baptism identifies you with Jesus Christ. It identifies you with the gospel of Jesus Christ that saves. It's also the door to the Lord's church, which is divine institution of growth and maturity. And so God's desire is for you to be saved and then baptized, scripturally baptized, added to a good Bible-believing church that preaches and teaches the Word of God. Now, which church do I join? Well, you know, I like this. Oh, we go over there on this day. We go over there for that. I go to Tom Thumb for this, and I go to 99 Cent Store for that, and I go to Aldi's for that, and, so I just shop around. Oh, really? But, what's the most important? That you can't find that in the Bible. The church at. To me, the most important thing in your criteria for a church ought to be, does this church, when I go to this church, no matter what they say, whether it's the youth, and by the way, the youth are in the fourth chapter of Romans on Wednesday night, the Bible is open. And it's made clear so I can understand it. Well, I'm not really into that. Okay. You said it, didn't you? I mean, salvation is just the beginning. You've got all these apps. Yeah. Holy Spirit. Woohoo! The Bible. And you do, don't you? Yeah. I've got my iPad here. I don't have a Bible. I got Bibles! Yeah. I got Bible studies. I got what I have. It's amazing. It's the most accessible thing. Bibles are so plenteous in America, we don't even care about it. Christians, you know anything about it. Well, I said, you need to get the Bible app and the church app. What? Don't fence me in. Yeah, be fenced in. The Bible, the language in the New Testament is inside and outside the church. It's put him outside. In the Bible, the language of the church of Corinth, put him outside for the destruction of the flesh. That's scary. I've been looking at that passage. Well, what's that about? Well, it's a difference between inside or outside. And he's talking about a local assembly. We are accountable. And that's not what people want. Now, I just took a lot of time to things that my people up there are saying, where is he? As God's people, we need to pray for these things. Pray for people to be saved. Pray for people to be obedient and enter the waters of baptism. Pray for people to make a commitment to a church membership. Pray for people to fully, faithfully attend church and get serious about their spiritual growth. I mean, those are good things to pray for. Maybe you need to pray for yourself. Verse 5, for there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. So as a Jew, this is Paul. He was a Pharisee. He knew the Shema. And that's recorded over there in Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 4. What it says. Oh, hear, O Israel. The Shema means to hear. Hear, O Israel. The Lord our God is what? One. He's one. There is one God. Now listen to me. Christians don't believe in three gods. They believe in one God that exists in three persons. He says, there is one God, but he doesn't stop there. And there is one, you see that, mediator between God and man. And that is the man. And notice it says man, Christ Jesus. That's all good, isn't it? Now, there's many different types of men, but there's only one true God for all men, and he has provided only one way of salvation to all humanity. And this one way of salvation involves a mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. That word mediator speaks of a bridge connecting two different people. Okay? And just as Jesus is presented here as the man Christ Jesus, well, he had to be a man to make the bridge. And just as a bridge must be firmly anchored on both sides, let me tell you what Jesus was. He was fully man, and yet he was fully God. At the same time, theanthropos. In other words, he was the man, Christ Jesus. Why? So he could connect us, bridge us, if you were, to God. He brought us to God, and there's only one. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Well, and say this is the context of prayer, and so I always view that as there's only one person you pray to. Well, that's, you can wear that too. That's good. We've got a priest. You know, I don't need to turn this around. I mean, if you need to pray, pray. You don't need me. Call the priesthood of the believer. So, you know, I'm about to die. Go call Brother Ron. Well, if I could be there, I would like to, but if you made a commitment to Jesus Christ in your heart, you can just go on home to Christ. You don't need me or last anything if you've gotten the first. I'm the one and only. I mean, you know, so we do have one mediator. He's our Lord and our Savior. And there's one way, one access, one door to the ark. Come on. Verse 6. Who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. So this sin, for sinful men to be reconciled to a holy God, sin's wages had to be satisfied. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is what? Jesus came to pay the ransom. The man, Christ Jesus, he had to become flesh. This is why it says, why in Hebrews chapter 2, great chapter, why did Jesus not take on the form of angels? Why did he have to take on the form of flesh and blood? So he could taste death for every man. And he did. He's the bridge. He died for you. He took your place. It was your sin, not his. He paid the, notice the word here, ransom. You know what a ransom is? I'm held hostage. Boy, aren't we? And he paid the ransom to set us free. There's that Christian liberty thing, you know? Free from the law and hopefully free from sin, right? Certainly the penalty. Paul says in verse 7, whereunto I am ordained, I'm appointed, I'm commissioned, a preacher, a herald, a proclaimer, an apostle chosen by God. I speak the truth in Christ. I don't lie. A teacher of the Gentiles in faith, the good news of Jesus Christ, and verity or truth. I mean, Paul traveled to the Gentile nations and the cities to preach and teach the good news of Jesus Christ. And I think that's so interesting because as a Jew, Pharisee, those are the very people he was raised to hate. You know anybody you were raised to hate? There's regions of the world where people, you know, the first, you know, memories of their childhood is you're to hate these people. No. Well, that's the most anti-Christian. There goes the blanket. Paul's blanket included Gentiles. And he says, you know, I just want you to know that all means all, and I'm practicing what he preached. Notice what he says in Romans 11:13. For I speak to you Gentiles as much as I am the apostle of the Gentiles. I magnify my office. In other words, you can be sure that Paul was praying long and hard for Gentiles to be saved. And as Christians, we're not merely to pray for people like us or even just people who like us. Jesus has commanded us to pray even for our enemies. He says, John 5:44, but unto you, love your enemies. Bless those that do good to those that hate you. Pray for those that desperately, despitefully use you and even what? Persecute you. So if you're in Myanmar and you're, you know, part of this Muslim refugees, or maybe a Christian, you need to pray. Pray for the leader of that country. You need to pray and intercede and that God could penetrate the darkness and pray for their salvation. There's the answer right there. That one mediator, verse 8. I will therefore that men pray what? everywhere. Now, we've gone for praying, you know, for all men and praying that all men could be saved, and then praying everywhere. That's pretty much sums it up, right? I found this. Sir George Adam Smith tells how he and a guide were climbing the mountain of Mount Westhorn of the Swiss Alps, and they were coming up on the sheltered side of the mountain, you know. And so, I can only imagine climbing the Alps. And he gets to the top, and he was so elated to finally make it. You know, the adrenaline's going. And when he finally gets to the top, and once again, he's on the protected side of the mountain that blocks the wind. Well, he finally got to the top and stood up like this and was almost blown right off the top of the mountain. And it's interesting because his guide says, "On your knees, sir. You're safe here, only on your knees." Aren't you glad that there's a safe place even on the mountain? Prayer works everywhere. I mean, prayer is appropriate everywhere, especially on mountaintops. But we're to pray at work. We're to pray before meals. We're to pray at restaurants. We're to pray at the company picnic. We're to pray at the Christmas party. We're to pray at the school before taking the exams, for sure. We're to pray in bed at night. And we're to pray with our eyes wide open driving to work. We're to pray in church. As we worship, because prayer is the highest form of worship. If you don't, then you're checking a box. You're just preaching another message. You're just singing a song. You're just... In 1 Timothy 2:8, it says, lifting up holy hands. Peter speaks of people lifting up holy hands when they're praying. Hannah prayed while standing. Solomon prayed with the hands spread out, lifted toward heaven. Ezra prayed and worshiped with his head bowed. Jesus prayed with his eyes lifted toward heaven. Paul prayed while kneeling. Jesus prayed falling on the ground on his face. Elijah prayed falling on the ground with his face between his knees. A publican prayed with his head bent, beating his chest. And I think you can pray with your eyes closed and your hands folded, even though that's not in the Bible. You can also play that. You're not going to catch me doing this. Well, might be good for you to do that. And maybe if your attitude's right, you'll end up on your face if you really have a burden. I mean, if I'm a Christian in Myanmar, I'm thinking, or a Hindu in Africa, a Christian in Hindu-controlled Africa, I'm thinking I might be on my face. We just, you know, late last night, out, just Sunday, I can sleep. And we get here. Anybody a favor? Prayer is not as important, the posture, as much as the attitude of the heart. Verse 8, without wrath. Pray this way, without wrath and doubting. Wrath speaks of vengeance. Doubting, well, that's just not a way to go to prayer. That's the opposite of faith, right? But when you pray, get your heart in it. And pray in faith. James 1, 6 and 7. But let him ask in faith. Nothing wavering. He that wavereth is like a wave on the sea driven, the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he'll receive anything. See, prayer is important to God, our Father. And therefore, it should be important to us. So there's this wealthy dad. He had all kinds of money, and he had an only son. And he said, "I will give you so much money every year, once a year on a specific day." And so you can only imagine living, being raised in that kind of home. Once a year, the son would come visit his dad to get his money. That's all. He would only show up. Sounds like
the prodigal son, right? I don't care about you. I just want the money. You can die. I want the money now. So once a year he would show up. And that's not what his dad wanted. Dad wanted his son. So he thought one day and he changed the rules. He says, I tell you what, rather than give you money once a year, I'm going to give you a little bit every day. And suddenly the pattern changed. That his son was there. He wanted to see his son. And this is the way your Heavenly Father feels about you. He wants to see you. He wants to hear from you. And that's what Paul is instructing the young pastor Timothy to instruct the church at Ephesus, inspired by the Holy Spirit, to remind us. So what about it? What about your prayer life? Do you have a prayer life? Do your prayers have life? Do your prayers have life? How powerful are your prayers? How pathetic are your prayers? How big is your prayer blanket? And your prayer list, does it contain someone who really, really needs Christ? It might be a family member. It might be a friend that really you know needs Christ. Maybe a Christian that's wayward. There's no better time to pray than right now. This is a house of prayer. Jesus cleansed the temple and he says, my Father's house is a house of prayer. Not so much a house of preaching, a house of praise, even though those are important, a house of prayer. So what about it? Do you know the one mediator between God and man? There's no other way. It could be that you're here and lost, and someone that's not even here now, but worshiping somewhere else, maybe in another state, is praying in worship for you today. Let's bow our heads. If you want to step out, you say, well, wow, you said a lot of things. Well, Paul did. Inspired by God, the Father, and the Holy Spirit for us today. You can renovate your life by doing this one thing that you can do anywhere. You know, pray for others and it'll get your mind off of yourself. And there's always people who have greater needs than yours. I pray that through these images that we flashed up on this screen, that it would just challenge every one of us about the people we bump into every day. More like people in our way, more than people who need to know. Oh, Lord, we need to be burdened. And we need to pray. Teach us. Lord, thank you for Paul. Thank you for a wonderful reminder about how big your expansive your purpose is and your love and inclusive. Oh, Lord, may us we rise above the politics. Rise above the vengeful, spiteful, mean attitude that permeates our culture. May we see men, women, boys, and girls just like you see them. And may it bring us to our knees. Lord, humble our hearts this day. Speak to us, Lord. And I pray for the one here that needs to come back to a fellowship through prayer. Come back to seeking your presence, living for you in Jesus' name. Amen. As we stand,